Good afternoon, everyone. This is Brother Lloyd. And to those who are keeping the Sabbath today, I hope you're having a blessed and peaceful Sabbath as always. Now, last Sabbath, I did a study on loving thy neighbor, which is the second of the two great commandments. So today we're going to go back and touch on the first of the two great commandments, which is loving the Father. So go with me to Mark 12, and we're going to start in verse 28, which this time refers to a scribe asking the question as opposed to a lawyer. And it reads, it says, "And one of the scribes came, and having heard them reasoning together and perceiving that he had answered well, asked him, which is the first commandment of all? And Jesus answered him, the first of all the commandments is, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord, and thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind, and with all thy strength. This is the first commandment. And the second is like, namely, this, Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. There is none other commandment greater than these." So, once again, this reiterates the two pillars of commandments, loving the Father and loving mankind. Now, he said that loving the Father is the most important of all the commandments. But the question is, what does this really mean? Because some people really need to step back and ask themselves this question so they can do accordingly. So what we're going to do is look at six ways that the Son has taught us to express and or demonstrate our love for the Father. And the first of that is knowing and obeying the Father's commandments first and foremost. And in Luke 11:28, it reads, it tells us that blessed are they that hear the word of God and keep it. Two things, you have to hear it and keep it. In John 14:21, it reads, it says, "He that have my commandments and keepeth them, he it is that loveth me, and he that loveth me shall be loved of my Father, and I will love him and will manifest myself in him." So, understand the biblical concept right here in these two scriptures. There is a hearing that takes place, it needs to take place, and there is also a need to comply with what is heard. Two things, you have to hear and comply. Obedience is the supreme test of our faith in the Father. Go with me to 1 Samuel 15. I'm going to start with verse 22, and it reads, "And Samuel said, Have the Lord as great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as in obeying the voice of the Lord? Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to hearken than the fat of rams. For rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft and stubbornness, it is as iniquity and idolatry. Because thou hast rejected the word of the Lord, he hath also rejected thee from being king. And Saul said unto Samuel, I have sinned, for I have transgressed the commandment of the Lord and thy words, because I feared the people and obeyed their voice." Look, Samuel told Saul what the Lord wanted him to do over and over. Saul heard the word, so he heard it, but he didn't follow through. He heard, but he didn't comply, and it cost him. And what did Saul say? He acknowledged that he sinned, but he also said that he hearkened unto the voice of the people. And there are plenty of you, plenty of us out here listening to people and following all these other forms of leadership around while disobeying the Father at the same time. See, we're hearkening to the voice of the people and not doing according to the Father's word, because it separates us from the people. You have to come away from that and stand on the word, because this is what is going to get you where you need to be. Saul was simply acknowledging that he had faith, he heard the word, but he didn't do the work. And we know that faith without works is dead. It's just a dead faith. So understand, we're called many times to put our faith into action. It's not good enough to just have faith. Our faith is best summarized in what? In the Ten Commandments, Exodus 20:1 through 17. And by the teachings of our Savior on the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew 5 through 7. So if you go read Exodus 20:1 through 17, and you go read Matthew 5 through 7, you'll get the strongest illustrations and examples and teachings of what it means to comply, to understand what the Father wants us to do. But throughout Scripture, there's not an area where we are free to live our life based on our own feelings of right or wrong. Not if we, you know, not if we're going to be a child of the Father's. We have to do what He wants us to do. We can't go based on how I feel or what I think or what they say or what this person says. The principles are here, and we must let them guide our lives every minute of every day as we set out to move forward. Perfect obedience must be our constant goal. And some of us aren't striving for that. We think we can do this and do that. Do this and do that. One foot in, one foot out. We have to strive for perfect obedience in obeying His word. In Matthew 7:21, our Savior says this: "Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven." You've all heard it. "But he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven." See, there's going to be plenty of people, just like plenty of people. You all know people that run around now. Lord this, Lord that, Lord, Lord. But they're not doing His will. And you know that too. That's why you have no respect for them. And the Father is going to treat us all the same. So simply calling on Him is not and never will be sufficient to enter into the kingdom of heaven. We must also do His will. Look, the parable of the wise and the foolish builders, Luke 6:46-49, our Savior compares what? He compares a man who hears the words and puts them into practice to build a house on a solid foundation, or rock, as he says, and it what? It weathers any storm. Who is the rock? Our Savior. Matthew 16:18 reads like this. Go with me to Matthew 16:18 so we can clear it up right quick. Matthew 16:18 reads like this: "And I say unto thee, thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." Now, understand that the Savior is acknowledging Peter when he is saying this. He says, without getting into another study, he says, "Thou art Peter, you're Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church." And then we're also told in Ephesians 2:20 to confirm who the rock is or who the foundation is. It reads like this: "And are built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone." What's a cornerstone? It's that one big stone in the corner of any and every foundation that holds up the structure. He is the chief cornerstone. So he's not only the rock, he's the chief cornerstone upon which all is built. On the other hand, a man who hears his words and does not put them into practice is like a house built what? On a weak or no foundation at all. It may as well build it on what? On sand. Because the first storm that comes along, it will cause it to collapse and be destroyed. So that's the first principle. Number two, we have to trust in the Father and His Son. John 14:1 reads like this. It says, "Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me." See, there's a belief in this that we have to have. There's a belief, there's a faith, there's a trust that we have to have in the Father and His Son and their word. John 6:28-29 reads like this. It says this: "Then said they unto him, What shall we do that we might work the works of God?" Verse 29, "Jesus answered and said unto them, This is the work of God, that ye believe on him whom he have sent." So the word says that we have to believe on him whom the Father sent to. Trust. Trust is a precious thing. We live in an age where rational thinking, scientific knowledge, secular government, and cultural diversity, with all these things, all these distractions, and many more are nothing more than blockades for what? Our simple faith. That stuff gets in the way of our simple faith every time. But yet, simple childlike faith is exactly what we are called upon to have. Just as small children trust completely in his or her parents, he calls on us to trust completely in Him and the Father in heaven. Mark 10, 13 through 16 reads like this. And they brought young children to Him that He should touch them, and His disciples rebuked those that brought them. But when Jesus saw it, He was much displeased and said unto them, suffer the little children to come unto me, and forbid them not, for of such is the kingdom of God. Verily I say unto you, whosoever shall not receive the kingdom of God as a little child, he shall not enter therein. Understand this, we are called to receive the kingdom as little children, because that's what we will be in our innocence. We'll be like little children, naive, eager to learn, not knowing much of anything, etc., etc. See, we have to enter that with that frame of mind about us. You can't go there think you know anything, because if you understand anything here in the Word, you barely understand this. So you know if we enter into the kingdom, we're going to have to enter as little children, ready to absorb and learn everything. So faith is different. Faith is different. Why? Because it operates in the spiritual realm. See, things of the material world cannot invalidate the truth of faith, nor does faith invalidate the things of the material world. There's no conflict between the two realms. We have to understand that faith is freely given as a gift from the Father. It's not derived from science, logic, or even rational thought. It's a gift, and we are all free to have it or not. It's up to us. Look, everywhere around us is war, prejudice, crime, exploitation, and all kinds of suffering. So you might ask, how can you maintain your faith in the face of such overwhelming evil? And it's simple in a sense. We're just simply called to trust in our Heavenly Father and maintain our faith in spite of all the incomprehensible evils in this world, of this world. See, we can and we should try to make our world a better place for us to be in as we live in it. So we should do what we can to make things around us better. But bringing it into perfection is the job of the Father, and only He can do it. If He sees fit, He's going to do what He sees fit, because remember, He has a plan, and He'll make whatever happens on His timetable, not ours. Nothing's ever done on our timetable. And look, speaking of trials and evils to come, the Savior says this, go with me to Matthew 24, and we're going to read verses 10 through 13. It reads, it says, and then shall many be offended, and shall betray one another, and shall hate one another. And many false prophets shall rise and shall deceive many. And because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. But he that shall endure until the end, the same shall be saved. See, like I said, we're called to simply be sincere, freely choose faith, and follow what the Father asks us to do. He would not give a miraculous sign that would force any of us to believe or go against our own will. Free will. He gives us free will. We'll always have that free choice to do as we please. He tells us in Mark 8 like this. And the Pharisees came forth and began to question Him, seeking of Him a sign from heaven, tempting Him. And He sighed deeply in His spirit and said, why doth this generation seek after a sign? Verily I say unto you, there shall be no sign given upon this generation, or given unto this generation. So, look, maintaining our faith in the face of all the world's disappointments, sufferings, and cynicism is a daily challenge. I know this, you know this, we all know this. But if you didn't have these challenges, what would be the reason for hanging on to your faith? So, this is why this stuff is all here also. But if you can meet this challenge, or if we can meet this challenge, we can rise above all these evils in the end. See, then we can be put at peace with the Father and with our own fellow man, women, children of the world, and even with ourselves. We can acquire that peace. Look, we're going to stop right there. That's two of the six ways. In the next video, I'm going to tackle a couple more. And just keep those two in mind as you go forward from today, because there are six, And if you understand, if you listen to all six and you really apply them to your life, it will help you in your daily strive or daily stride in this world. And with that, remember that the Father gives us free will and the enemy gives us temptations to go against that free will. So we have to choose what is right. This is Brother Lloyd. I'm out.